years ago. The biggest claim to fame for Berlin was the fact that a few movies were filmed there, one of which was Runaway Bride, with Julia Roberts and
Oh yeah, I
Richard
remember
Gere, of
that.
course, and then the Disney film Puck Everlasting was filmed here. And so, there's a very large historic hotel called the Atlantic Hotel right in the center of town. And that was the hotel in which Richard Gere stayed in during the Runaway Bride. So I used to play piano at that hotel. And it was always remarkable to me how many little old ladies that were tourists on buses that were coming to town. And they would sort of tap me on the shoulder, and I would think that they were asking for, a song. And they would just say, where is the Richard Gere room? And so we actually shot a music video off my first record called Smoky Cafe. We shot it in the Atlantic Hotel at that place, and some of the scenes were actually in the Richard Gere room, just as sort of a tip of the hat. It's a beautiful place, and aesthetically, it's gorgeous. And it does have that sort of time capsule feel to it. But yeah, it's been very interesting how, as my music has been heard by more people around the country, or I guess even the world, thanks to iTunes, how the little town in which you live in, you can help sort of showcase it a little bit as well. So, yeah, it's a cool place to live, and it's a cool place to raise kids for sure.
That's awesome. So, Burden of Proof is kind of the first in a series of albums that you're putting together as a modern symphony, and I really admire the approach that you're taking for that because so often today you find artists that are just putting together kind of one song here or one song there and just kind of throwing those things out. But it's clear that you've got a full kind of plan here for a modern symphony. And your background is as a violinist, which is pretty incredible, and it speaks to the musical talent that you're really bringing to this. And I wonder if you can talk about how Burden of Proof fits into your modern symphony.
So, Burden of Proof, if you listen to it, track to track, there's a lot of different genres that I'm sort of tipping the hat to and writing my songs under the umbrella of those particular sounds. So I looked at it, and I looked at this project as sort of a way to reintroduce myself in a larger way to more people. So if you think of any symphony, the first movement is always where you're trying to catch people, and where composers would try and introduce those themes of which they would be sonically telling their story. So I looked at Burden of Proof as the first movement of the symphony, as the influence record. So, we start off, you'll be hearing some of the songs sound like, vintage New Orleans jazz. There's an homage to 70s soul with Talk of the Town. Honesty is sort of an early 50s, kind of early Elvis Costello kind of nod to 50s music. Burden of Proof is, the title track is absolutely my tip of the hat to the Beatles. There's some weighty and sort of ballads with Hot Rod, and then Shiny Brass Ring, which finishes the record, is really my attempt at writing a big anthematic Bruce Springsteen number. And that sort of ends the record. So from Burden of Proof, then we'll go to different sounds in different genres, I guess. So the second movement, which traditionally anyone who likes classical music will tell you or will be able to understand this. The second movement is always sort of the down tempo or the adagio movement. So I took that as, let's make the country Americana record in movement two or record two, and then really ramp up from there. So that record, the second record, will be called Pennsylvania, which
Pennsyltucky?
really. Pennsylvania, because I grew up in Western Pennsylvania,
Yeah.
and if you think about that whole, remember James Carville when he's
Yeah.
talking in a political interview about Pennsylvania, there's Pittsburgh on one side and there's Philadelphia on the other side, and in between is Kentucky. And so, the rural bits of Pennsylvania, that's really where I came from. My
Yeah.
first job was at a dirt racetrack.
Wow.
I grew up in a very, very rural area. Both my neighbors were farmers. And I realized at age 17 that if I wanted to be a journalist and a musician, I probably had to leave Western Pennsylvania. So I did. And you know, it's funny. I remember riding in the truck on my grandparents' farm with my grandfather, and he was a big fan of old country music. And I, you know, as a kid, you'd always used to rail against that. And
sure,
now
yeah.
I found myself listening to those old country records. And I'm not talking about sort of the boy band country that is popular on country radio now, but really that old Three Chords and the Truth stuff, Waylon Jennings, Willie Nelson, you know, Johnny Cash, Buck Owens even, and really loving the stories, you know, and being sort of glamored by the stories and the sincerity of country music, much in the way that Ray Charles was when he wrote one of my all-time favorite records, Modern Sounds of Country and Western Music. So those have been all sort of points in the road. So it's been an interesting challenge to really think about how I want the words, which are very, very important to me. The lyrics are really at the forefront of all of this. So it's been interesting to package these lyrics and these messages and these stories into different sonic palettes.
Yeah.
And I've been loving the freedom to do that. And so they don't all have to sound the same. And I don't have to try and, you know, I may be known for being sort of a bluesier musician, but I don't have to just be pigeonholed to write just bluesy songs. So that's the other thing of this, is this pursuit of artistic freedom, of really trying to make it about the songs and what do those songs need to sound like, and then taking all of those different sounds and packaging them into the records so it's a full album and not just a assortment of songs that are rolled out together on a digital platform at one time.
Yeah. And, you know, it's so nice to see artists doing that. And you don't see a lot of that quite as much these days. You know, I think back to the 70s when, you know, people were putting together rock operas, right? And, you know, putting together these long stories that go across songs. And in your case, not just across songs within one record, but across four records, you're putting together a whole storyline here, which is really incredible. And I certainly admire that. And you seem to be like somebody that is just oozing with talent, because
I appreciate that.
It can't just be contained to one record or four records. You've got side projects like the one that we're talking about today, also here with Journo. And so what's going on here with Journo, and how are you looking to integrate your background as a journalist now with your amazing talent as a singer and songwriter?
So leading up to the November election, I got a call from the BBC, and they wanted me to do a series of stories about, it was sort of the idea was a juxtaposition of different places in the world that were similarly named. So in this context, Salisbury, England, which is near where Stonehenge is, versus Salisbury, Maryland, which is about a half an hour from where I live.
And is that where the Salisbury steak is from?
I don't think so. but, you know, that's, you never know. Some small towns take ownership of things, even if it's not theirs. So it tends to happen. But yeah, I was sitting there, and I had done this story the night before the election that it aired in England. And then once the election results came in, I had to go and do a reactionary piece. And I remember sitting at my computer trying to write this script and realizing that millions of British people were going to be listening and trying to palette what had just happened in America during the election because of the story that I was about to write. And, you know, I've done a lot of things in my journalism career at a very high level, and I just fundamentally had such a hard time writing that script. And I just toiled with it and struggled with it. And it got to a point where my wife sort of came in the dining room where I was working on that. And she said, "Why are you freaking out about this? You know, the Brits just had Brexit a few months ago, so they're going to be able to figure it out.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's still going to be a lot of questions, but this is just the world we live in now." And, you know, the thought that came to my head was, what a time to be alive. And it was sort of this, you know, thumbing your nose, very, you know, I don't know. I guess regret or uncertainty saturated in a healthy dose of irony. So when I sat down to write that song, I wrote it very much with Randy Newman, who is one of my all-time songwriting heroes and mine.
Yep.
I wanted it to have humor. I didn't want it to be a militant protest song because, you know, a quarter of the country wanted or got the result that, you know, they wanted in,
yep.
in the American election.
Yep.
So I didn't want to, there was more to it than just being angry. So mm-hmm. I wanted it to mm-hmm. be funny. I wanted to look at society. That's why the opening line of that song is, "What a time to be alive. We're teaching robots how to drive."
That's and, right. And all then, these self-driving and, cars.
Right. And so then the next line of it was, you know, "But we're all merely traffic on the cyber 405. What a time to be alive." And if you think about it, you know, we are literally just, we are targets for clicks. Everybody wants our click.
Yep.
Because that drives ad revenue and that drives volume. And then, you know, that's just the world we live in. So we're all in cyberspace, just stuck in traffic along the cyber 405.
Uh-huh.
And so I didn't start with a political statement with that song. I wanted it to be funny. I wanted it to be, you know, really make a statement straight away about the world in which we live before I start talking about any sort of political thing. And,
yeah.
and you know, the third verse is where I really got a little bit political, but it wasn't even, you know, one way or another. It was just laying it all out there. You know,
right.
Do you think this is what they had in mind when they said the revolution would be televised?
I love that line. I love that line. You know, again, it goes back to, you know, even the spirit of the video that you put together for The Twist. It just kind of draws back to, you know, the early 80s almost. And some of the things that were going on television around that. For some reason, that original commercial for Apple from the early 80s, where the drone,
yeah.
where everybody was just kind of walking along like a robot, just kind of marching along. And then, you know, then along comes Apple, right, and breaks the mold. You know, that same kind of a spirit is coming through in The Twist. It's coming through in this song to me. And, you know, I think it's really important to look at the lyrics and especially now because, you know, it seems that you're channeling people like Bob Dylan, Tom Waits, those types of artists here again. And if you think back to Dylan, you know, he used music back in the 60s, 70s as kind of a political statement. And I suspect that we're going to see more with the divisiveness that's going on in the country here. More things like this with music as an outlet.
I would hope so. I think, you know, I was talking to my cousin about this and you know, it seems that, you know, if you look at, you know, popular music over the course of a long span, there have been moments where thinking music was at the forefront of what audiences were willing to listen to. And certainly that folk explosion, you know, led by, you know, Mr. Zimmerman in Greenwich Village in the 60s, that was thinking music.
Yeah.
But there's also been a lot of drinking music or music, you know, that is focused more towards the body than the head.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm paraphrasing David Byrne's sentiments from his wonderful book, you know, How Music Works. And so I feel like the rise of synthesizer music and this sort of creating sonic landscapes with computers that people listen to while they're working out or drinking coffee or taking yoga, that has sort of been this new disco kind
mm-hmm,
of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like maybe this election will shake things up to a point where, you know, lyrics shouldn't be throwaways. And another reason why I put that song into the Tiny Desk contest was because, you know, I worked in public radio and at NPR at a large member station for a number of years. And I remember within the last year or two hearing a music reviewer on NPR saying that he doesn't even listen to the lyrics. He just listens to the sounds. And I thought to myself in that moment that that's irresponsible as
yeah.
a music reviewer. That would be like being a restaurant critic and going to a restaurant to review it, but only ordering soup. So, you know, lyrics have become sort of these throwaways, and I don't know why that is.
It shouldn't be.
So,
and, you know, if you think about film, and I know that you're also a documentary filmmaker, and I was watching I was watching the Oscars last night, and one of the when they got to the script writing award there, the presenters got up there and they brought up a quote of saying, "What's the most important thing about making a movie?" And or what are the three most important things about making a movie? Number one is.